There's lots of action in New York these standing moments, apart from the United Nations. This big forum that Michael Bloomberg was hosting at the Plaza. In fact, I was coming from there. And I've just heard a lot of people talk about what we're addressing here. So it looks like a lot of important people are converging on this low emission solutions or their need to have a low emission society going forward, which is encouraging, I would say, kind of an alignment there, at least in words. Now, first of all, thanks all of you for coming, and again, thank you, Jeffrey, I think he will appear sooner or later, for being here with us. Let me address a few issues that are important, I think, for the purpose of this conference and in general for what happens in the energy world. We have, as we all know, a big transition in the energy industry at this very moment, as perhaps in many other industries. And there are big drivers of this change. One of them is the pervasive transformation that the digital world is bringing upon the sector. Not only directly, because our customers are digitized and therefore their needs and the way they interact with us changes, but also indirectly because the industry, technology, and the performance of machines we use change a lot because of the sensors and the data that we are able to extract out of the things we have, the plants we use. And then we have a second large force driving this change, which is the incredible progresses that material science is bringing about. We experiment that in our daily life constantly. Things we own get better and better and better. Our glasses are thinner. The textiles which we wear are better. They perform better. They last longer. They are thinner, lighter, cheaper. There's a lot of improvement in all kinds of things. And this turns also in improvement in the performance of plants, of components, more efficient, cheaper, better, longer lasting, that require less maintenance, less spare parts. That's happening. And these two forces are really shaping a change that is today happening in the world. Why are technologies like renewables now convenient and increasingly convenient? Because of these two drivers. And because this is happening and will, in our opinion, continue to happen in the next decade at least, then we have this huge transformation of all the means of generating electricity that we have used so far. This is happening. It will continue to accelerate throughout this decade. And that's good news, because it means that we can generate electricity cheaper. Cheaper electricity is a good idea. With no emissions, and that's fantastic. And also, in a more distributed and pervasive manner. So, less big things, many more smaller things. There is a second aspect that this change brings about also a relatively reduced profile of risk from an investor standpoint. The typical investment cycle is reduced. It's a 3 years maximum. That means you're not out with your investment for decades, or for 5 years, or 6 years, or 7 years before you start generating and making your money come back to you. Fits the world much better. So we have this in the power industry. Good news. But then we have also, because of these two forces that I described before, a second big change happening, that electricity becomes more and more useful for for different applications where so far electricity has not been considered useful. You will remember, when you are taught when you're a kid, it's not a good idea to heat with electricity. It's a bad idea because, to show you that it's a waste at the end. True, if you use fuels to generate electricity. Not true if you don't, if you use something else. And therefore, now, just for that reason, and also because there are ways of heating that are much more efficient than we had when we were studying how to boil water to make tea. So there's a lot more things that happen now on technology that enable to use less electricity generated with zero marginal cost forces like wind and solar. So at the end, electricity is making ways in our society which were not thinkable before. I'm not going to talk about electric cars, I'm not going to talk about these things because it will take a long time, but you all know that this is coming, it's happening, and we all understand that technology is going to bring electricity in different sectors, more and more pervasively. So that's good too, because if we have a way to reduce emissions and eliminate them going forward, produce electricity, then we also eliminate additional emissions that today are not associated with electricity but are associated with transport, heating, and other parts of our economic activity. So all these things bring about a fantastic opportunity to reduce and eliminate greenhouse gas emissions. And I am very careful not to use the word decarbonize, because I think semantics are important. Decarbonize is a limiting word, because it only fixes our mind to that carbon thing. But there is a lot more than carbon in greenhouse gas emissions. And by the way, CO2 is a unit of measure, and the others are multiples. So we're talking about methane, 20 times, and other stuff. So, why do we use the word decarbonizing? Just because it's a simpler way of doing this, but be mindful, it is a limiting concept. We should use greenhouse gas elimination, not decarbonization word. That said, I think we have, because of the dynamics I have just explained, this huge opportunity. But then we have also a second observation that we have started to understand during the past crisis. What has surfaced is a progressive but unstoppable delinking between GDP growth and energy consumption in most of the OECD area countries. This was, it has been for ever since the beginning of times, and historically, when you have GDP growth, you have energy consumption increase. To the point that energy consumption increase was used as a precursor for GDP signaling GDP future growth. That was as strong as it was, as this link was. Now we've seen decoupling of this in most of the OECD countries happening in the last 5 years. And this has been somehow puzzling at the beginning. It's now being kind of rationalized and some things, finally we get it. And it has to do with the pervasive presence of more efficient ways of doing the same things. So our refrigerators cool the same way, but more efficiently, and so forth and so forth. That's one explanation. Part of the explanation. The other one is that the structural change in our economies in the OECD world has happened, and we have less energy intensive activity, whether we like to admit it or not. Now, is this going to happen everywhere? If we look at emerging economies, the signal is not as strong. So we still see GDP growth associated with energy consumption in emerging economies, and we see a transition point in those economies that cross the $10,000 per capita GDP point. So as soon as a country crosses that line, it goes into the capital mode. And if it goes, it stays at the left of this threshold, it's still growing energy demand as GDP grows. We think this threshold will progressively move to the left. There's no reason that emerging economies should be, by some kind of strange motive or explanation, inherently inefficient. They will be efficient as our economies, sooner or later, and probably sooner than we think. In fact, there is a great study by the North Korea that the DNV Energy Transition Outlook 2017, which I encourage you to read, that project at the capping of the world from this GDP energy loop. That means that because of technology, we will use less energy and fuel the growth and emit less. So this is something that will happen according to their study across the period between 2020 and 2030. So it's not that far away. Why am I saying this? It's because it's not all technology. Well, can this thing happen earlier or later, or even not happen? It depends on the policies and the regulatory frameworks that we will impose on our societies. So, if we assume that for some strange reason we would start or continue in some places to subsidize fossil fuels, which is a practice that is very, very widespread, there is a lot of that still. If we assume that this will continue or even get worse, then this trend will slow. It will slow down and we will look at more emissions, even if they would be economically not rational. But subsidies sometimes are like this, not rational. So if you would do that, I think you would look at this horizon moving far out, and therefore more emission being left in the environment for longer. If we don't play with that, if we stop tinkering with incentivation to fossil, we just let the forces of the market work, then we would look at a threshold of crossing this moment between 2020 and 2030. And then if we do the other way around, if we push for regulatory frameworks that disincentivate fossils, this would probably accelerate. That's the only thing we can do at this moment, provided that I personally believe no one can really think that we can influence the evolution of technology. I think that this is beyond our control already. It is a force that keeps evolving itself in an organic manner, and there is little we can do about it, okay? TENCOM is going in the right direction in this team, and other teams perhaps not. If you look at what happens in genetics, you start to worry whether the world is going to be a world or something else in the next decades. But if you look at our sector, the energy sector, and the electricity, it's great what's happening. We are in a fantastic moment. We can only slow down this evolution if we are really stupid, or we can try and accelerate, but that's in our hands. And that's why I think we should stop using the small word decarbonization and embrace a larger horizon, which is eliminate greenhouse gases altogether, not just look at carbon. That's really an important factor which we impose on ourselves. I think I've finished the 15 minutes right now, and I'm happy to see Professor Sachs with us. So thank you very much for your attention, and hope you have an interesting day going forward.